Today the topic is about teams, founders, and culture. I'll try to do a very brief introduction and also put it into perspective of what we had last time. So, agenda is basically as follows. I'll do a quick introduction. Here we have Mads from Preseed talking about teams and founders and culture from that perspective of, you know, an investor seeing a lot of cases, both on how they evaluate them when they go in, but also how they're going to grow them as we go, you know, because there's a big difference getting the 500,000 Discovery loan to be ready for Series A, also in terms of structure and team. We have a break, and then we have Mick Stroyberg from Good Monday. He will tell about this, about building teams and culture from a startup perspective. And finally, you to have some common Q&A, and the most important thing, beers. So, I'll do a 2-minute wrap-up of what we discussed last time. Last time was about metrics and data, and basically the one thing were that when you start, you know, I'm in business angel myself, and when you start and go into a startup, you can basically get around with no data, right? Because it's all about a dream. This market will be huge. We have a cool team, come invest in us. That's basically how it goes. I'm actually in the process of investing in such a startup, and they have no data. That's okay. Then you can get around on the first things, right? Then in 1 year, when you have burned that money and it further, you know, suddenly the investors will ask all the questions. So the market, the price, and all that. And the further you get, you're going from selling a dream to selling an Excel spreadsheet, right? And that's basically the point, that is that you need data, and the further you get, you know, you should use those data to guide yourself. But I can trust you that all investors and partners will demand that data also. Then we have two really, really cool speakers. We had Jakob Egelund, actually formerly from Preseed, now at Templify, which talked about KPIs. And I basically think one of the most important slides he had was this one, where he said, well, if you look at those data on revenue and costs from a classic bookkeeping perspective, Templify is doing really, really bad. Oh my God, that's basically the story you read when reading some of the Börsen or whatever, you know. This company is losing a lot of money. It's a problem. No, it's not a problem. They would not have raised $17 million if that company was in problem. So what's the issue? The issue is when we're talking about early stage startups, you can't measure in the traditional bookkeeping way. So how are you measuring such startups, especially if you're looking into software as a service? Jakob had this great slide talking about some of the key metrics in evaluating software as a service. Of course, they also can also be valid for startups, but that's basically it. If you have a software as a service and you come, for instance, to a VC later on, I can guarantee you they want these. And if you can't answer those by heart, you know, you're in trouble. We're not going to detail with that, but that was the topic from last time. If you were not here last time, all the videos and the recordings of the talks are actually available online. Then we have a startup in the Preseed portfolio talking about metrics from their point of view. And I think it really sums up, you know, where Jonas said, well, you need to have one metric to guide you. One overall metric, that was his point of view. I agree, by the way. But that changed over time. And of course, that depending on which startup you're in. But in the case of Pento, you know, initially they focused on customers. You know, how many are really interested in that? So you can actually say it's more users than customers. Later on, when they're building the product, it was about net promotion score. So do our customers actually love us as a guidance on we are the right track? And now they're focusing more on building revenue to see if they actually can scale the business. Again, your case might be different, but I think the major thing here is that your key metric changes over time. So how does that link to where we're here today? Of course, investors and yourself need data, but there's one thing that's even more important than that, and that is having the right team to build that data. And you can ask any entrepreneur or any investor, and they will basically say that one thing that is important is the team and the culture you build. And that's why we're having this session today. Because it's a learning all of us having to say, oh, initially we think it's about the great market or great strategy or even a patent. But honestly, it's not. The key determining factor is, can you gather the cool that's why we have the two perspectives. We have mass and we have big. So if I should introduce this about team founders and culture, we actually have to have some of the terms in place. And one of the terms is here, actually, are you a founder or an employee? What's the difference between a founder and an employee? What would you say? Anyone? Because it's some, you know, I think it's very important. And I see the difference in the way of, you know, how were the company when you got in? Are you getting in and getting a salary? Are you getting in as part of a founder group that has some kind of deal where you most likely have no salary? And there's really a big difference, because normally when you're a founder, you are introduced to this vision, maybe by your co-founder, and you agree it's a great idea. But there isn't really a company, there isn't really customers or maybe a product, and if you can get a salary, you're really, really lucky, normally a company. And that's basically normally start in a basement like this, right? Or in a small office, so it's really, really chaos. At some point in time, you said, oh my God, we're three persons who started this company. Now we hire this cool guy I went to school with 5 years ago. And that's, I don't know how many of you have been in that situation, but it's just the main, main, main thing. Because the three first, they're in it of, due to that passion and the equity you're having, and suddenly you are hiring a normal person. A normal person meaning that actually a normal person that actually believes that that person will have salary each month. You know, that actually expect that. Maybe that person actually have kids or house, they actually need that salary a lot. Where when you're in the founder, it's just like, oh my God, can we get salary this month? Great, right? So I'm just saying there's a big, big difference. And to simplify it even more, I think there's basically like three types of status or three types of employees. You're as a founder, you start a company. So why are you doing that? You're doing it because you have this passion, of course, it's great for an upside. You have a big, big stake of the company, normally plus 20%. And I said normally because, of course, sometimes it's equally shared, sometimes not. Well, that's a good idea or not. We can discuss that. That's a really, really long story. But you have a big, big part of the company. Do you get salary? Well, normally no, right? It's really, really hard to expect you get a salary from day one because you actually need to build a product and get customers. So why are you there? You have a big part of that company. That actually changes over time. Because maybe you are employee number five in a company. And that could be a software developer. That software developer's market value, if you're working for a big corporate, might be 60,000 kroner, 70,000 kroner. Do we pay that software developer 60,000 or 70,000, 80,000 kroner? Most likely not. You say to that person, oh my God, come on this train. Of course we have salary. You can get 40,000, right? And then you get some equity. And how much equity is that? That can be 0.1 to a few percent. It's very rare that you see them get more than this, right? Maybe you've had this CEO coming from the outside, you give that CEO 6, 7, 8%. So while they're here, it's actually mixed. Suddenly you have people that are not only here for the ownership, but actually also because they have a real job. Fast forward, you're successful, you need to hire employee number 100. You don't have to be a mad genius to calculate that when you hire employee number 100, you're not giving that employee 2%, right? So you're basically giving 0.0 whatever percent. It sounds like really, oh, you're getting 1,000 shares. Sounds great. But that 1,000 shares is 0.0 whatever percent. So why is that person there? Well, basically, mainly, that person has it as a real job. Of course, there is some bonus, whatever, and some warrants, but honestly, that's not really well. But on the other hand, you give the person a salary that is close to the market average. The reason why I point out this is that because it's extremely important in terms of building that culture and building that incentive structure and also corporate structure, because it's very different employees you're getting. The person that dares to take that or that is very different from the person that wants to join a startup when they have 100 employees. So when many of my friends said, oh my God, they will I consider joining a startup? Then I said, great, but how risky can it be? Because you can say you can go into a basement with two persons and no salary. This is just one of my companies, Pineo. We have 30 people. Castle and Positive, you know, approve themselves. Okay, that's like medium. And then you can, like a Trustpilot thing, right? I'm sure Trustpilot brand themselves as a startup. I'm sure they have a fantastic culture, but it's a 500-person startup, right? So if you're here, you're getting a great salary, a few wants, 20-25% of the company, no salary, and something in between. So basically, I said to employees, or potential employees in startups, what are you in for? And that actually is the other thing, that is that most of us who are doing startups, we find ourselves that we hated HR when we worked in the corporate world, and suddenly you're an HR person. So what do I spend 50% of my time on? Recruitment. And that is because I can't convince you to join my startup based on salary. It's impossible. Honestly, if the employees think a little bit, they also realize that even for once, because risk adjusted, it's a bad deal. If it's really about money, they should take the good offer from the corporate, take all the bonus, and take the bonus and invest in startups. So why are they joining? Because we're selling them the vision. That's basic. And that's not something you can do with an ad in Job Index. That's something about taking them in the office, show the vibe, getting them drunk, you know, all that kind of normal tricks, maybe all substances, whatever, you know, legal and illegal substances. But that's basically what it's about. And then you can say, well, now we have the perfect employee in. But that's only half of the cake. The other half is, how do you make these people that have taken the jump into your startup to perform? And that's about this building a corporate culture. We could talk about culture for 8 hours from a theoretical perspective, but you all know how it is, right? You can go into two different companies here. In one company, you're formal, you respect orders. Other, it's informal. In one company, they collaborate in one way, in other, they can't collaborate on. So it's all these underlying beliefs and values that are so hard to change, but it can just make a fantastic difference. So the best startups and the best CEOs I know of are the ones that know how to build such fantastic culture. And it's not easy, because it's impacted by everything from how you incentivize people, to how you hire people, to how you fire people, and everything in between. So basically, the challenges you're having as a startup in terms of teams, founders, and culture really changes. You know, in the initial phase, it's about, oh my God, how do I convince a technical co-founder to join my startup when I have no salary? Oh, here suddenly you're a mid-sized startup, and then you're 30 people, and you can't manage the company the same way as you could when you were 3. How do you suddenly have senior developers or senior associates? How do you do that? That's really a struggle. And you said if you manage to be so successful as Trustpilot, you know, we have suddenly other issues, right? Because then you would say, how can we keep ourselves innovative when we are honestly not a startup anymore? So that's basically my introduction to how I see this issue. And again, I'll just repeat and say, it's the most important thing in a startup. And it's a cool we're here at Google, because actually the CEO of Pineo, he was actually an employee at Google before. And without ever having worked at Google, I can see some of the things he's trying to replicate out there. And again, without being an expert in Google, I'm 100% sure that a big part of that success is also some of the corporate culture they built. So again, it's extremely important for your success of your startup.
I should wrap up what we're talking about today, and of course this is my slide, so it's the most important thing. That is just that when we talk about teams in startups, just have in mind that we have very different perspectives, whether you are three person in basement looking for a co-founder, or whether you are a successful 100 person startup looking for your next employee.
I'm not saying it's getting easier, I'm just saying that it's different challenges you're facing. And actually, one thing we haven't discussed too much today, but I think all agree that is that the person in this company might not be the right person then. And it's really, really hard, even among co-founders, right? Because I think which Mads also talked about this creative phase. Some of the most creative people that can do this evaluation, validation of market or whatever in the early stages, most likely that person that can give you the first customer is not fantastic over here. Because here you're managing a team of 50 salespeople and kicking them or whatever, and it's basically about execution. When the first stage is about, oh my God, how do I find the first? So just have in mind that just because you set the team, often you have to unset team members. Different stages. What I remember from Mass was really about how they saw these different stages, about the team and the structure is very different in the MVP phase versus we're getting ready for a Series A. You know, it got more and more formalized. It more and more looks like a real company, right? And again, coming back to different people, different ways to manage people. What I took away from Mick was, well, he reminds me in many ways. Mick, do you know Tuangalo from Audio? Well, he could be a twin, right? Because when I hear about his view on what? Yeah. But he still doesn't have any hair left, right? So, okay. But this is about that you basically hire for personality and for energy and not for qualifications. I think it makes total sense. And I also think what I take away from you is you admit that it's something you can do now. It's not scalable. But that's also great because what you basically said is, you know, what the first 25 or 30 people we hire is what creates the next level, right? So you do unscalable thing here because you know it's so important to find these first 30 people. And you don't care whether that method works for when you're 1,000. And I think it makes total sense. Of course, there's a difference whether you're hiring a specialist or salesperson. But I think it was also, what I also took away was your take on millennials is about, well, they're driven by other motives. How to deal with them, you know. They're not driven by the same things that make us happy.